So far in this series, we've seen how we can convert an analog signal into a digital PCM encoded stream. We can transmit this data stream through digital transmission media or through devices, but eventually you'd want to save the stream as a file in permanent storage. I use the word stream here. It's really the perfect word to describe the underlying digital signal, as a stream of data, a river or a torrent of data even. You can also think about the stream as a conveyor belt delivering packets of data. And what are these packets of data? They're simply the amplitude values of the audio samples encoded as binary numbers, if we have chosen PCM encoding. In essence, the computer interprets the PCM stream as a large collection of binary bits. But just this data alone is not enough to do anything of value. If you want to play the audio back, for example, all the computer has to go with is a series of binary bits. The computer doesn't know at what rate the audio signal was sampled at, or the bit depth that was used, or if the collection of bits are even audio or not. We need some extra information that describes what this data stream is, that describes what to do with it. We can wrap that extra information along with the data stream in a nifty little self-contained box. This is a container. And almost all digital media that's stored on the computer is made up of data streams that contain the bulk of the media and some additional information, or metadata, that describes this media. And both of these are wrapped into a single container. A container is an abstract concept to what actually exists on a computer, a file format, recognized with an extension. The file format that you might choose to use would depend on the application that it's needed for. Does it need to be compressed? Is audio fidelity important? Does the file need to be accessed across platforms, or is it restricted to a certain operating system? There are a flood of different file container formats out there, so let's just focus on a single one. The WAV file format, a very commonly used container for storing audio in its raw, uncompressed form. But not always. The WAV file format was developed by Microsoft for use within the Windows operating system. But the specification is open to view and replicate, and currently is supported cross-platform and can be used in any operating system. Besides the usual information that should be provided, such as sample rate, bit depth, number of channels, and all of that, we can also embed other metadata into the container, such as the name of the song, the artist, the genre, the album name, copyrights, and other annotations. Since every application reading a WAV file needs to know exactly where to look for getting this information from within the container, and since every application creating a new WAV file needs to know exactly where to write this information to, a specification documentation is published and made available to the public. Every application that supports the WAV file format would need to adhere to these specifications. So this is the original specification from 1991. A whole 100 pages of it. I've put links to this and whatever else I talk about in this video if you want to check it out. I wouldn't be surprised if you didn't. But the internet is filled with concise, watered-down versions of the original. And in a page or two, we'll describe exactly what you need to know about the WAV format. Over here, I'll try to give you my graphical outline of it. Further watered down, further condensed. My aim here isn't to give you a precise overview and explanation of the specification, but to rather give you an essence of what a file format would hold, how it would be structured, and the motivations for why they're designed the way they are. In fact, a lot of file formats follow a similar approach, so you'd get a general overview of other file formats as well. Before you write any audio data into the WAV file, you'd need to describe what the file is even about. You want to say, hey, this is an audio file, and hey, here's how you read it. So you add that basic information as a header to the file. In the header of the WAV file, the first thing that's written is RIFF, R-I-F-F. RIFF is Resource Interchange File Format, a generic file format template based on something called chunks. We'll get to that in a bit. RIFF tells the application that's reading this WAV file what kind of file format this is. The WAV file format is basically derived from the RIF format, and both are made of units of data called chunks. Each chunk contains relevant data bundled together. One chunk may contain all the audio data. Another could contain all the data that describes the audio format. Another could contain playlist and identification information. Each chunk has an ID associated with it, and a length field which holds the size of the entire chunk in bytes. Right, we're getting ahead of ourselves. So the text string, RIF, is the first item to be written. Obviously, we're writing to a binary file, so everything is written in binary zeros and ones. So the characters of RIFF can be written into 4 bytes. Each byte contains 8 bits, so each character can be represented in a unique combination of 8 bits. We can see this in action. Here's a WAV file saved on my computer. Let me open this in a text editor. This is a bit silly, because obviously a text editor doesn't know what to do with a WAV file. All it'll do is try to open this binary file and try to interpret it as text. And hence, you get a lot of garbled, nonsensical data. But you can still see little items of text pop out, like RIF, and WAV, and FMT, and data. But all the rest of it, well, you can say that it's unparsable. These are supposed to be audio sample values represented as binary, and not text. After the first item, you write the size of the entire file. We don't know the size of the file yet, so we can ignore this for now, and remember to come back to this after filling up everything else. You need one more header item, a text string called WAV. All of this is mandatory. The specification dictates it. The rest of the items in this file are all different chunks, the chunks that we described earlier. Since there is an ID and a length associated with each chunk, the application reading this file can ignore chunks that it doesn't need and jump to chunks that it's interested in. One important chunk is the format chunk, or FMT. The format chunk contains information about how the waveform is stored and how it should be played back, including the type of compression used, number of channels, sample rate, bits per sample, and other relevant attributes. Most of these are self-explanatory, but the interesting attribute is compression. As I noted earlier, a WAV file is traditionally used to store uncompressed linear PCM audio data. In almost all cases where you may use the WAV file, this is true. Assigning 1 as the binary word to this compression field will mean that no compression is used, and the coding format followed is pulse code modulation, or PCM. Here's a list of other possible compression schemes that can be used with WAV files. In this list, some of them are uncompressed. Some are compressed but lossless. And some more are compressed and lossy. For example, the MPEG compression scheme accepts audio data encoded with a specific lossy compression algorithm, used in MP3, for instance. Although you can put virtually any type of encoded audio in the file, the application reading the WAV file might not choose to support it and can reject the file if it doesn't know what to do with it. You just end up getting an error that the file can't be played back. The application will need to know how to decode the compressed audio into something that it recognizes, like bitstream PCM. If it doesn't know how to decode the compression, it won't be able to play back the underlying audio. This is completely fair. The application reading the WAV file doesn't need to know all the compression algorithms out there, and it just can't. There are hundreds, and they keep evolving over time. So what the application would rather do in this case is have a bunch of little programs that can be linked with it. These programs are designed to decode a specific type of encoding algorithm, and these programs are called codecs. A codec is a cool, made-up term for a portmanteau of coder-decoder. So if your application doesn't know how to decode the audio, you can just download a codec for the compression scheme used, a little program that can be linked with the application, which helps decode the compressed audio. In the case of MPEG compression, you'd link the lame codec to the application. Simple. I hope that clearly differentiates between a codec and a container file format. I know a common point of confusion among people is when to use what in a sentence, and this confusion is sometimes inflamed when both have the same names. For example, FLAC, or FLAC, is a popular container file format for storing audio. FLAC is also the name of the codec used for lossless audio compression, which is in turn used within the FLAC container. You see what I mean? It can get a bit tricky. Simply put, a codec is a method for encoding and decoding data, in this case audio. In comparison, a container is what holds the grouping of compressed audio as defined by the codec. Let's just say that we don't use any compression, and the audio data is uncompressed PCM. This audio data, in its entirety, is stored within a single chunk called data. This will by far be the largest chunk in the file, since this will contain the bulk of the audio data. If it's a mono track, meaning if the number of channels is 1, the audio samples are arranged serially, one after another. If it's a stereo track with 2 channels, the audio samples are interleaved. Left and right audio samples are alternatively written to the file. We discussed this in the previous video where we talked about time division multiplexing. That's really all there is to containers. We can have more chunks if we choose to add more metadata. Some of the other chunks that are supported with the WAV file format are shown here. Lastly, I want to make one modification to this illustration. Since the WAV file is composed of just chunks, the header section can actually be treated as one large overarching chunk, which internally contains a bunch of sub-chunks that we just talked about. Chunks are a great way of organizing data within a container. Since each chunk has a specific purpose intended, and since each chunk also advertises how large it is, applications can quickly jump to different sections of the file by reading just the size information and calculating the position that it would need to seek to and find the next chunk. I hope that provided a simple and blunt overview of containers and file formats through the scrutiny of the WAV file format. The internet is a vast place, so are people's preferences. Due to these preferences, some containers have grown in popularity to a point that they're de facto standards now. Feel free to explore the different ones out there. Just because some aren't popular, doesn't mean they aren't good.